Welcome to another session of this series, Estimation of Critical Gap at Unsignalized Intersections. I explained the concept of critical gap and follow-up time in one of my earlier sessions, and it is extremely important to watch that video first to better appreciate this session. The link for this video, if you have not seen it, is given in the description box. Unsignalized intersections are the most common type of junction on any network. The important point here is that these junctions do not give any positive signal or control to the driver. He or she is not told when to leave the intersection. Driver alone must decide when it is safe to enter the intersection. And drivers always look for safe opportunity or gap in the traffic to enter. You can yourself see in this video how the gap is being used at unsignalized intersection. A vehicle will wait here for a gap in the opposing stream to take a right turn. This is called the gap acceptance theory. Requirement of gap will depend upon the size of the vehicle and the movement being executed. More is the conflicting traffic, greater will be the gap required for a particular movement. So it depends upon the type of vehicle also. It depends upon traffic volume on major street. Gaps are measured in time. In the literature, these gaps are also referred to as headways. So when we say critical gap, it basically means critical headways. At uncontrolled intersections, the movement is under certain order of priority, and drivers must respect the priority of other drivers while accepting the gaps. And if you look at this figure, this is a common practice to number the movements at a unsignalized intersection. This is the major street, you can say east-west. This is a minor street, north-south. The movement at major streets are numbered from 1 to 6. 1 is taken right turn from left side, and 6 is taken as left turn from right side. The movement at minor streets are numbered 7, 8, 9 on northbound approach, and 10, 11, 12 on southbound approach. And if there are pedestrians also, then 13 and 14 are on major street and 15 and 16 are on minor street. There is a priority of movement at unsignalized intersections. Traffic generally on minor street is controlled by stop sign, and traffic on major street is assumed to move uninterrupted. Now this is the ranking of the movement. This is the ranking of the movement as per United States of America manual, which we call US HCM 2016, and these movements have been modified to left right conditions, and this is as per Indian conditions, Indo HCM 2017. There is no change in priority for rank 1 and rank 2, but in Indian conditions what we found that the rank 3 and rank 4 are interchanged. In case of US HCM, the through traffic on minor street is taken as the rank 3 movement, and right turn from minor are taken as rank 4 movement. Whereas in Indo HCM, right turn from minor is taken as rank 3 movement, and through traffic on minor street 8 and 11, they are taken as the rank 4 movement. you can understand the meaning of this ranking through this figure. Suppose at a two-way stop control intersection, a vehicle arrives from minor street. That is movement number 11. And when it arrives here at the stop line, the driver finds a vehicle already waiting at major street and it is to go right, movement number 1. And both of them, movement number 1 and movement number 11, both of these drivers are looking for a gap in stream number 5. The order of priority is that this number 1 movement is rank 2 and number 11 is at rank 3. Therefore, the first gap in the stream number 5 must be utilized by movement number 1, and this movement should wait for the next gap to occur. You can further understand this ranking through this small video which I have taken from an intersection in United States. There is a major road east-west and minor street which is north-south. A vehicle arrives here from the minor street, another vehicle arrives here from the minor street. This is to take right, that is our left turn, this is true. Now this is a higher ranking and therefore the first gap should be used by this vehicle and this vehicle should wait for the next. That is the meaning of ranking of movement at uncontrolled intersections. The definition of critical gap and follow-up time is given here. Critical gap or critical headway is the minimum gap size in the major street that drivers in the minor street will accept. So this is the gap size required to make entry of one vehicle from the minor street. And if the gap is long enough, then more than one vehicle will complete their maneuver in that gap. Then time interval between the two vehicles on minor street using the same gap in the major street is the follow-up time. This I have already explained in my earlier video. The gap seen by the first driver on the minor street is called the lag. Now there are several methods in literature to estimate the critical gap or critical headway of a vehicle. And the most popular method is the maximum likelihood method. It calculates the probability of critical gap lying between the largest restricted gap and the accepted gap. So here you need the data in pairs of the largest rejected gap and the finally accepted gap of each driver. The likelihood within the sample of n observed minor street drivers is obtained by this function. And this is the distribution of rejected gaps, distribution of accepted gap, and this assumes that the critical gap values of drivers will follow a log normal distribution. Log normal distribution is skewed to the right, and if all drivers accept the first gap without rejecting any gap, which is a general case in case of mixed traffic, then this method can give very trivial results. Now, during field studies on intersections in India, it was observed that drivers do not follow a well-defined path while entering or completing a maneuver. And they generally try to use the first gap, or you can say the lag, whichever is available when they reach the stop line. The priority are not fully respected, and sometimes minor street vehicles force their entry into the intersection area, and that results in slowing down of the vehicles on major street also. The vehicles generally clear the intersection in a zigzag manner, and therefore it was thought that the manner in which a driver clears the intersection is more important rather than the rejected gap. So occupancy time method is used in Indian Highway Capacity Manual to estimate the critical gap of a driver. It depends upon the driver behavior. It depends upon geometry, the size of the subject vehicle, opposing traffic, and manner in which it clears the conflict area. This is the time needed to clear the intersection safely. Irrespective of how it clears the intersection. So, occupancy time and accepted gap will vary among drivers and therefore they will follow a distribution. If we take FA as the cumulative distribution function of accepted gap and FOT as the cumulative distribution function of occupancy time, then this will be the kind of distribution. And to safely clear the conflict area, the probability of accepted gap being more than T should be greater than or equal to probability of occupancy time being less than or equal to T. Now, if this is satisfied, this if inequality is satisfied, then this will be the intersecting point of two distribution curves, one FOT, that is occupancy time, and another is 1 minus FA, that is accepted gap. And this intersecting point will represent the minimum gap in the major street that a vehicle in non-priority stream requires to safely clear the conflict area. And that is a critical gap. So this is the method given in Indo Highway Capacity Manual to estimate the critical gap of a driver. Now this requires the conflict area. Now this is also defined in the manual. What is the conflict area? This shaded portion here is the conflict area for left turn from minor street. This is the conflict area for right turn from minor street. A left turn area, we assume that the occupancy time starts from this moment when it starts entering the intersection at it ends when the rear end of the vehicle clears the conflict area. Similarly, for right turn from minor street, the occupancy time starts from the time when the front of the vehicle reaches the conflict area and then it ends when the rear of the vehicle clears the conflict area. So similarly, you can see for through traffic and right turn from major street also. So as I told you that the critical gap will depend upon the type of movement and it will also depend upon the type of vehicle. A smaller vehicle can clear the intersection quickly and they will require lesser gap. So this is the critical gap values given in the manual for different movements and for different vehicle types and also for different types of major street, for two lane undivided intersection and for four lane divided intersection. So for right turn from major to minor, that is movement number 1 and 4. So there are the critical gap values for different types of vehicles. And as the complexity of the movement increases, as the priority of the movement reduces, the critical gap requirement will increase. Now, what we found in field that the critical gap also depend upon traffic composition of major street stream. And generally, there is a tendency of the drivers to reject a gap when the gap provided is by a larger vehicle. So if truck is coming, a driver will have the tendency to reject a gap even if it is reasonably long. The critical gap was not found depending upon the volume of conflicting traffic. because that by definition that is the absolute minimum time required to make a movement, and therefore volume is not the criteria here. So this is the relationship between critical gap and proportion of large vehicles in conflicting traffic for different types of subject vehicle, for two wheeler to trucks. These are the seven categories which are used in Indo Highway Capacity Manual, and this base value is to be corrected for the percentage of large vehicle in the traffic stream. And you can see that the trend is similar for all types of vehicles, and therefore the critical gap is to be adjusted for percentage of large vehicles in the traffic stream. Now this proportion of large vehicle is to be taken only the traffic stream which is moving on major street. So FLV is the adjustment factor for large vehicle, and PLV is the proportion of large size vehicle in the conflicting flow, and that is the logarithmic relationship. So these are the adjustment factors for different types of vehicles and for different movements. FLV, these are the factors FLV, and you can calculate what will be the critical gap value for a type of vehicle given the proportion of traffic stream on major street. Now follow up time, I told you in the first slide also and in the last session also, that when the headway between two vehicles on a major street is large enough to accommodate more than one vehicle from the minor street, then the time interval between the two vehicles accepting the same gap is the follow-up time. It is not difficult to measure in field, but in case of heterogeneous traffic conditions, because there is no proper lane discipline, it was assumed that follow-up time will be 60% of critical gap. And this is not only in India, in several other studies also it has been assumed that follow-up time is 60% of critical gap. So friends, in this session we have learned what is critical gap and follow-up time at unsignalized intersections, what is the priority of movement as per Indo Highway Capacity Manual, and how it is different from US Highway Capacity Manual, what is the conflict area at an intersection for measurement of occupancy time, and occupancy time method for estimating critical gap, and also how it is adjusted for large vehicles on major street traffic. Thank you very much for watching this video. If you have liked, please share. My God. If you want to suggest any topic to be covered here, please do write in the comment box.